introduce the faculty and talk about the format for the next 2 hours. Rick Miller, Associate Dean, will give you the prayer.
Our Father in Heaven, we're grateful for this beautiful day. If the opportunity we have to meet in this seminar, we're grateful for the wonderful surroundings that we have, the wonderful facilities. We're grateful for our speaker, Dr. McClanahan, for her safe arrival here and for her presence here on campus this day. We pray that will bless her throughout the day. We're grateful for all that we have, and we ask that bless the food that we'll partake of a little bit later, that will be nourishing for our bodies. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Rick. I think you all know Dean McElby. This is Gordon Lim, Associate Professor from the School of Social Work. And on my left, Alan Hawkins, Professor from Home and Family Living, is that right? And Stephen Barr, Professor from Sociology. The person you probably don't know is Dr. Sarah McClanahan. And you've probably all read the bio that we sent around, but I'm just going to go over it again briefly, just so you can feel impressed. Dr. Sarah McClanahan is a professor of sociology and public affairs at Princeton University. She is a faculty associate of the Office of Population Research and is the founder and director of Blenheim-Fahlman Center for Research on Child Well-Being. She currently serves as editor-in-chief of The Future of Children, a journal dedicated to providing research and analysis to promote effective policies and programs for children. She is the past president of the Population Association of America and has served on the National Academy of Sciences Institute of Medicine Board on Children, Youth, and Families, and the boards of the American Sociological Association and the Population Association of America. She currently serves on the advisory board for the National Poverty Center, the board of trustees for the William T. Grant Foundation, and the selection committee for the William T. Grant Young Scholars Award. She is the author of many articles and books, including Fathers Under Fire, The Revolution in Child Support Enforcement, Social Policies for Children, Growing Up with a Single Parent, Child Support and Child Well-Being, Child Support Assurance, Design Issues, Expected Impacts, and Political Barriers as Seen from Wisconsin, and Single Mothers and Their Children, A New American Dilemma. Dr. McClanahan has received numerous awards and honors, including the James S. Coleman Fellow of the American Academy of Political and Social Sciences, Distinguished Scholar Award from the American Sociological Association Family Section, and Pro Humanitate Literary Award for Parenting and Child Development in Non-Traditional Families from the North American Resource Center for Child Welfare, the Duncan Distinguished Book Award, and the Good Distinguished Book Award for Growing Up with a Single Parent. She is an elected member of the Sociological Research Association and has been a visiting fellow at the Russell Sage Foundation and the Center for Advanced Studies in the Behavioral Sciences at Stanford. She earned her PhD in sociology from the University of Texas at Austin. Welcome, Dr. McClanahan. What I learned about her last night is that she is a beloved grandmother. I called her a couple of days ago, and she was busy tending her grandchildren. And I also learned last night that she's a member of the faculty in social work at Columbia University. So are you on the commutes or is he?
We do it together.
Okay.
We live in both places.
It's a privilege to have you with us today. Now, the format for this seminar, we've asked three faculty members to share in a kind of response to Dr. McClanahan's research within the context of their own research interests for about 10 minutes and then lead a discussion that for about another 10 minutes. So approximately 20 minutes each to help us generate enthusiasm, interest, learn ideas for the future of research. We hope that we'll all leave with some excitement, some ideas for how to build off the research that Dr. McClanahan has done and what it might mean to our own research interests. Then we'll wrap up with Dean Magleby, and halfway through, somewhere along the way, we're going to have lunch. Robin will tell us when it's time, right?
Okay.
Okay. Now, this is all being recorded, and Matt Kiefer is in charge of that, and he asked me to ask all of you who participate to try to be somewhere near a microphone and to repeat questions for the benefit of the recording. Now, this recording is not going to be aired on KBYU. It's just for our, I guess, archives.
Well, and for people who couldn't come today that might want to listen to the conversation or in the students.
So it's not to make you nervous.
And there are little discreet microphones on the table, so don't just speak up. I think it'll be the better way to do it than worrying about stage presence.
So let's start with you, Alan.
Okay, thank you. And these mics are about the right distance. I won't have to. Are this fine, Matt? Okay. Well, thanks for this invitation. I think Sarah, from my own perspective, Sarah McClanahan's scholarship over the past 15 years has had more impact, I think, than any other in the field of family studies, and particularly on issues of social policy relating to families and marriage and family formation. I've been a personal witness to how seriously federal and state policymakers take her work. They know it, they refer to it, they cite it, and believe it or not, they actually use it to think about social policy and what kinds of things they should be doing. I'm delighted that we're honoring her with the Hinckley Chair today. I want to focus my comments briefly on two issues. The first one takes a little more explanation, and the second one is just a final thought. It'll be fairly brief. I think it's important for us to understand the paradox that Sarah's work highlights. For nearly a generation now, there's been a strong stream of scholarship that chronicles a demise in the institution of marriage and speculates about a diverse set of replacement institutions that will take its place. I'm going to unfairly label this the Stephanie Kuntz stream of thought. Kuntz is a social historian who's been a prominent voice that arguing that there's an inevitable march of history towards a progressive tomorrow where a strong institution of marriage, at least as defined as a married man and woman, usually involving children and in a lifelong union. I think she's been a voice to say that is at best a nostalgic memory and something we are fading from at this time in history. The issues Kuntz raises aren't to be dismissed lightly by any means, but to me, the bulk of good social science that explores family formation and dissolution these days, and I think Sarah's work is in the forefront of that body of scholarship, points out in important ways that marriage is becoming more salient and more important as a social institution, not less so. Whereas in the past, the institution of marriage had a more taken-for-granted status and generally ordered people's lives from cradle to grave, today it does not do so. But marriage is held in high esteem in our society, perhaps as high esteem as it has ever been, and so high that many do not feel that they can enter through its portals. Very few reject the institution of marriage, and researchers are finding that membership in the institution of marriage matters significantly to our well-being and especially to children's well-being. So the intriguing contemporary paradox is that those who are most able to lead sufficient lives outside the bonds of marriage and the most privileged members of our society are enthusiastically marrying and have good odds of sustaining a long-term healthy marriage. Those who need the economic and social benefits of a healthy and a stable marriage the most are the ones who struggle the most to enter and maintain healthy marriages. Those with the most resources in society choose to marry, generally have good marriages, and may be coming as close as any generation in history to attaining the ideals that the institution of marriage is ascribed to. Those with the least resources in society find those ideals farther and farther from their personal reach. These individuals are not so much nostalgic for a traditional past, but I think they're hopeful of a future where a healthy, stable marriage will order their lives and the lives of their children. And so far from fading into a false nostalgic past, I would argue that marriage now is more salient, more desired, and more psychologically powerful a social institution than ever. And I think it's more important of an institution than we could have possibly dreamed a generation ago. And it's also creating a very worrisome social divide, what Sarah and others have called a marriage gap, that we must address as a society. And I agree with Sarah that this is much too important of an issue to be passive about and to be endlessly patient about, that we need to address this with social policy. I wonder how Sarah would analyze policy changes recently enacted by the passage of TANF reauthorization that just occurred last week. It seems clear to me that policymakers have been listening to Sarah's thoughts about how to address these problems and thinking in the same way, at least generally. The past Democratic and the current Republic administrations appear to be moving in a direction generally consistent with the policies that Sarah has recommended. There's continued investment in the earned income tax credit, though I'm sure we could argue that more would be better. More money is being given to childcare, although again, many will argue much more is needed. Paternity identity is now receiving substantial attention at federal and state levels. Child support enforcement has increased considerably. And the feds are also examining income testing requirements in welfare programs that discourage work and marriage. And they've been encouraging innovative policies to try and deal with that. And for the first time, some funds will go towards helping low-income couples gain access to the educational programs that may help them learn better skills for forming and sustaining healthy marriages. So I would be interested in hearing your thoughts about that. You may have a little different perspective than I do. I think you're a little more up close to it. Just a final second meta thought I'll share about Sarah's work, because I think it shows the way to a more centrist and unifying force in both scholarly and social policy circles. The recent NCFR decision to distance itself from policy efforts addressing marriage and family formation, a process that unfortunately I observed up close and personal the last few months, puts NCFR outside the mainstream of serious academic and policy thinking now, I think. I've been in several forums the last 6 years with strong proponents of both the ideological left and right, and they were debating amicably and constructively about policy questions related to marriage and family formation. One that I can think of just off the top of my head involved Irv Garfinkel and Robert Rector, who couldn't, as far as I can't think of any two people who are further apart on the political spectrum. But very, very constructive engagement. And I suspect that Sarah has seen even more of these forums, and I'd enjoy, you know, hearing about your perspective, whether or not you've seen the same dynamic that I have, or maybe I'm a little Pollyannish about that. The supposedly opposing sides have found much common ground in both analysis of the issues and appropriate policy applications. It's been so far removed from the simplistic red state, blue state kind of rhetoric that the media throws at us constantly. I think good research, the kind that Sarah has done, exposes ideology and partisanship for what it is. Good research is a force for convergence, not divergence. And to me, that's very refreshing. So here's to more good research, well conceptualized, well designed, well executed, and well applied to social policy in the United States. Those are my thoughts, perhaps a little more formal, but I wanted to get them out in that way.
I'd like to invite you to respond first, Sarah, and then if anybody who has an interest.
Okay, and then we do the others. Well, thank you. I thought your summary of my paper was just excellent. I was quite shocked, let me just say, when I went to, this was the address I wrote for the, when I was president of the Population Association. You're supposed to kind of write, you know, a big thing that's broader than your own research. And when I went to look at all these different, I knew that the trend in divorce was different by education, and that it was really the lowest educated women who were having the non-marital births. I knew that the divorce rate had leveled off since 1980, but it wasn't until I really put together these trends and looked at them to see that the lines are really crossing. For the college-educated women, divorce had gone down since 1980. And then when I looked at some of these other issues about the women working or the children and the father's involvement, I realized that they were also different by education group. And they were different in a way so that all the good things were going to the children of the highly educated. All the good family behaviors were going to the children of the highly educated women. This was a big surprise to me and to a lot of my colleagues. And because there's been this idea that Sweden, you know, in Sweden there's lots of non-marital births, that these are all pretty stable relationships, they're all cohabiting, and this is just sort of a, you don't have to get married to have a stable family. So then I went and started looking at these other countries, and I found that they too had this educational difference in who was actually marrying and which children were spending time apart from their father by the age of 15. Lots of my colleagues in Europe had said, well, this may be true of the U.S., but it's not true of Europe. But as far as I can see, maybe not as extreme as it is here, but as far as I can see, it is true in Europe. It's not the case that cohabitation is so different, but so you have to really pay attention. Are you talking about cohabitation before children, or are you talking about cohabitation once a child is born? And if you're looking at where the children are born, in Europe, they're also much more likely to be born within marriage if the parents are highly educated. And I recently had a colleague that told me he's looked at Japan now, and it's the same thing in Japan. So I think that it'll be interesting to see more research coming in on this sort of gap or this divide between the highly educated and the less educated. And of course, what this means is that we already know that education is strongly related to earnings and employment. And so if you think of marriage and the stable family as kind of creating a sort of social capital, which is what I think of it as doing, so now we're getting the reinforcement of the economic and the social capital. So as you said, the people that have the least economic resources and need, in a way, the social capital the most are losing out on that front as well. And the people who could most afford to probably get along without a strong social network are choosing to have one and to have a more stable one. So I think that's a very disturbing long-term trend for what might be happening in the post and, you know, modern post-industrial or whatever it is world. So, and in terms of the politics of all of this, I'll tell you just a couple of stories. When I started out, I was a single mother, and I, in the 70s, and I went to graduate school, and I heard all of the stories about, you know, how the family was changing, and divorce was fine if it made the parents happy, and all of these kinds of things. This was a very popular idea in the 70s, especially in sociology, which is where I was studying. And being a single mother, I, of course, had a personal investment of having this be true. So when I got to Wisconsin, which was my first job, there was a set of articles that were written in the New Yorker by Ken L. Weddo about the underclass. And these articles described the underclass, and there was a lot of references to the kids being born to single mothers and the kind of contribution of single-parent families to this problem. So we had a seminar at the Poverty Institute where I was working there about this set of articles, and I was quite disturbed because I thought, this is wrong. This is the wrong story. Single motherhood isn't contributing to these things. So I went running. I was the second year assistant professor. So I went running down the hall to check with my colleagues, you know, to say, where's the research that shows that this isn't true? Because I thought it was wrong. So they were pointing me this way and that way. And every time I'd go and find one of these articles, basically what the article would say is that the research on the negative effects of single motherhood on children has a lot of flaws. It wasn't done correctly. But that doesn't mean that there's no effect. You know, just to say we can't trust the research we have, that it does have negative effects, is not the same as saying we have shown that it does not have negative effects. So that was really the state of the research at the beginning of the 80s. So I spent the next 10 years of my life trying to show that single motherhood had no negative effects on children, since that's what my children were experiencing. And every time I looked at about 8 or 10 different data sets, and I tried every kind of statistical model in the world, and I controlled for all the different variables I could get my hands on, and every study I looked at came up with the same answer, which was that the children in the single parent families did considerably worse than the children in the stable two parent families on any dimension: mental health, economic status, relationship quality, everything I looked at. So I was, I finally had to choose if I was going to be a scientist, a social scientist, or if I was going to be a politician. And I decided I'd like to be a social scientist. I was better at it. So in that sense, you know, then of course that finding was very, very unpopular with most of my colleagues, who were very invested in saying that there really was nothing happening to the family that was bad for children. So I spent a long time sort of arguing with them, with the people like what you're saying, and I still try to belong to those organizations. And so I kind of keep up, because there's just a lot of wrong information being passed around there about what the government's doing, what the marriage programs are doing. You know, we're going to make poor women live with men who are violent, and all of these kinds of stories that really aren't accurate at all. Just let me touch on the point you made about Robert Rector. So my husband, Irv Garfinkel, comes from a long, you know, history of sort of socialist beliefs. Although his parents were actually members of the Communist Party. So he rebelled, his parental rebellion was to argue that, you know, Stalin was not a good guy, and that the problems with China was not a plot, you know. So he is, you know, but he does consider himself very much a Democrat and a liberal. But he also believes very strongly in families. And what's been interesting, we've been on the advisory board of this new marriage initiative that's partly going to be funded out of the welfare reauthorization bill. And Robert Rector, who's a real strong conservative, is also on that board. And it's amazing. Irv and Robert agree on almost everything. And they disagree with some of the kind of liberals in the middle. You know, because
the middle, yeah.
Because for instance, the liberals are afraid that one of their biggest worries is that the marriage programs are going to take money from the programs for the poor mothers, and they're going to use it for the marriage programs. And their idea is they just want to hold on to whatever money the poor single mothers have. They don't want to lose any of that. And so they want for instance, they want you have to be on welfare in order to get into the marriage program. Well, Rector and my husband both think, you know, that is the stupidest idea that you could, you know, the point is to get to these parents before they go on welfare. You want to stop the break. You don't want to have to send them first into the program. So, anyway, they do agree. And also, Robert Rector also agrees about the marriage penalty of what the welfare rule is now, is that even though they changed the law that says a married couple can't receive welfare, they can now. I mean, most of the states, half the states have changed that law. But the problem is that if you're married, you have the same income test than if you're not married. In other words, and so it's very hard to be married and have low enough income to qualify for any social aid from welfare. So if what they, and Rector and Garfinkel totally agree about that we have a big, that marriage penalty because of the income testing in the programs is a very serious problem. And in talking about what to do with the marriage initiatives and how to make them what's called Marriage Plus. So this is part of the debate now about the marriage education programs, is what else are they going to include? And there's Marriage Plus is, okay, we're going to have counseling and the traditional marriage program for these low-income couples. But if we find that the guy doesn't have a job, or if the mother or father has a mental health problem, or there's a drug, a substance abuse problem, that couple or that person will be referred to the appropriate agency who is out there waiting to help them. And the case manager will sort of see that they get into that program. And they'll go in as a couple rather than as a single mother or a single father over here, so that they will be treated, they will get an additional set of benefits beyond just the counseling. And the third piece of that that Garfinkel and Rector both agree that they would like to do, but which I don't think can happen because it's too complicated, is that they would actually like to neutralize this income test so that to the extent that if a poor mother was to marry the father of her child, she would not end up losing any kind of Medicaid or food stamps or support that she is now getting, because that does exist. But according to what the bureaucrats say.
Yeah, they've kind of drawn the line in the sand.
They can't do that. Yeah. That would be too complicated. Yeah.
Too complicated or too expensive?
Too expensive.
You think it's not complicated, it's just expensive.
You're absolutely right. It would be very expensive. But they use the complicated. They use, there's no way for the state to get a waiver to do this, that, and the other. But you're right. Because to raise that income test so that it really does make the marriage not a loss for that couple, you would have to, that would cost a lot more money. Especially if the program were successful. Right, in the short run. That's all.
I assigned 20 minutes to each of these three faculty members, knowing that we would go beyond the 20 minutes. But I would like to just ask for, let me take two or three minutes and see if there are questions from you all that you'd like to address to Alan or to Sarah. Yes, please introduce yourselves. Questions, comments?
Samantha Wilson. As I've
from
political science and economics, as I've followed this literature over the years, particularly studies from fragile families, is that I always come to the conclusion that policy-wise, wouldn't it be more cost-effective to focus on the other question about rather than incentivizing fragile families to marry? That we could do more to preserve fragile families or threatened families that are married. Do you understand what I'm saying? It seems like so much of the Bush initiatives are on, you know, promoting people entering into marriage who are going to be a high risk of divorce anyway, where there's a lot of relatively stable but possibly threatened families for whom we would get a lot more out of our policy dollar on keeping them together rather than on kind of encouraging people who are at risk to divorce anyway.
Are you on the Supporting Healthy Marriages?
No, are you?
I am. And you're right. And the feds think you're right as well. There's currently a 9-year...
That's meaning the bureaucrats or the Bush administration?
The Administration for Children and Families has a 9-year, $39 million program evaluation study designed to help married low-income couples who have already made a substantial leap and a substantial commitment against a lot of odds, and what kinds of educational and support programs can they put in place for those families. And so that study, it's about 2 years behind the one that Sarah described, they'll be going through site selection this year to test programs and see there, because I think they agree. If people make that jump against the odds, we ought to be out there supporting them as much as we possibly can, and probably have better odds of success in that program than we do in the Building Strong Families program that addresses fragile families.
In the interest of time, I'd like to move to Gordon Lim and turn the time over to you.
Mine actually might be pretty quick because the topic is a little bit, includes this scope, but it actually goes beyond it as I focus on a very specific population, that of American Indians, and some of the impacts that American Indians face. And so I know that that's a very, very narrow topic, but I think that a lot of the issues that are faced by American Indians, are faced by people of color, aren't faced by the general population. So that's kind of the stance that I'm going to kind of take towards this. But the idea of fragile families is not only important, but is vital for American Indians and people of color. But for my topic today, talking about American Indians, so we're going to have an interesting discussion on this, because that's, to me, that's my area of interest. So I wanted to just talk about two points real quick. Fragile families, impact, what is the significance for Native communities? And then kind of maybe even take it a step and how does that apply to a lot of what you do, which is probably not with American Indians. But if you look at the idea of survival, which is a little bit of a different concept, a little bit of a different way of thinking that we have to think about it in the general American population, because for American Indians, this idea of fragile families equates to survival. Because what happens is if this family starts to break up, if this father leaves, if this child leaves, over the course of two generations, you're going to lose membership in your tribe, and your tribe will almost virtually die. And so it becomes imperative for the tribe to enter into this debate and say, how do we preserve not only the marriage, but the family unit? And so, take for example, you know, you have a father who has a child in or out of marriage or wedlock, and then all of a sudden disappears. The impact of that is huge for American Indians, because not only is the impact for the mother and the child, but when this child starts to grow up, this role that this father now takes, which is now becoming uncle, grandparent, elder, is no longer there. And so it's an interesting dichotomy when you look at that impact as well, because when you look at, you know, children growing up without a father, what's the impact of that? But then you add in when you have a communal model and the impact of extended family, because for a single mother in an American Indian family, where that system is set up to take care of her is if the father is gone, for example, grandfather steps in, uncle steps in, elder steps in, or somebody else steps in. But the problem comes with what happens when you have generational father stepping out, or multiple persons within that system leaving, you know, when there is no uncle, there is no grandfather. And so this idea of preserving the family and marriage initiatives and divorce, it becomes more pronounced for American Indians. The other thing I wanted to just mention as well is this idea of politically how American Indians fit in. I think most of you kind of know how that works, but I think it's worth mentioning a little bit, because where I come in and where I work is with service delivery systems, so like the Indian Child Welfare Act, with Title 4E and Title 4B for children's services. But a big issue for debate with regard to inclusion of Indians is almost with any legislative piece that involves families, there is a discussion that involves how does this impact tribes. And for example, like with welfare reform, there's actually funding set aside so the tribes can actually run their own tribal services, TANF programs. And so it becomes really imperative that tribes are not only a part of this, but are taking initiatives and trying to tackle these issues as well. And so I forgot to mention just one thing that Carol Ward really brought home in her latest study, but I wanted to just see, when you look at, so I'm going to take a step back. I forgot to mention this when I was talking about the breakdown and the fragile family issue. When this system breaks down, what happens is the impact, as Dr. McClanahan has said, is huge. With Carol's study, you know, we have a third
to, in some states, almost 50% of Native kids not graduating from high school. I mean, that is, you can imagine half of this a particular population not graduating and the impact that that has on. On reservations, and this is a welfare reform issue, you have many reservations that have over a 50% jobless rate. And in one way, that's good for welfare reform because they could actually be exempt in some ways, but it's a tragic event when you have over half of your population jobless. With regard to children's issues, the children, kids count, well-being indicators, on 9 of 10 health and social social well-being indicators, American Indians are not only below the national, but are almost significantly below. And so, it's kind of a gloomy picture. But on the other hand, when you look at how this system, when it works, it's an amazing sight to see. Because there are these protective factors built in that if you can take this fragile family, this family that is struggling, and build in these elements of security, it is an amazing thing to see. And so, for example, another interesting debate is with regard to casino tribes, but because they have money. But one of the things that a number of tribes, like in Southern California, are doing is they're doing their own marriage initiatives. And Sven, what you talked about with regard to prevention, you know, with a lot of people have this idea of prevention, that if we can get them to start marriage right, that will save them later down the line. Tribes have kind of looked at it both ways. They say that not only do we need to look at marriage initiatives, and there's a tribe in Southern California that gives $2,000 for any Native couple to be involved in a marriage promotion class. But then what they're doing is they are trying to loop around as well, and you might even call it a treatment issue. How do we help the families that are struggling? And that's where this communal model really starts to take place. And so there are educational incentives, there are job promotion, and so the tribes are really trying to address that as well. And then just recently in 2003, where did I note that? The Administration for Native Americans Social and Economic Development Strategies announced $20 million just set aside for Native people to address and to kind of get think tanks together on this issue, and how do we resolve, and how are we going to take this, take up this call as well. And so I guess one of the discussion items I would like to pose to you is, you know, are there differences that we should be looking at with regard to specific populations? And what are the impacts and what are the differences that some of the issues that these fragile families, or the idea of stability, might be looked at a little bit differently with regard to some of our groups of color, communities of color. So I welcome your thoughts on
Thanks,
that,
Gordon.
And open up for any
Would
other
you like
thoughts.
To respond first?
So I think the idea of the effect on the tribe is really important. I've seen some, you know, obviously we've looked at the effects on the children, and George Akerlof, the Nobel Prize economist, has written a very interesting paper called Men Without Children. And it sort of looks at what happens to men when they're not attached. But the idea that there's also this community level effect, I think that's very interesting. And it's hard to study, right? In your case, you're sort of saying that the father actually leaves. It could end up with being a, there are no men anymore in the community, or there are only a few, or they're very peripheral, and so they produce children, but they don't really stay, they can't be an uncle or a grandfather, because after so many generations, they're all gone. So actually, maybe with something like an Indian population that does have a kind of geographic boundary, you could actually study to what extent is this phenomena associated with a kind of a disappearance of, you know, are the men just hanging out in a different neighborhood, or are they literally gone from the, as a resource to the tribe? The other piece of this program, you know, there's one program to strengthen fragile families, that's called Building Strong Families. There's another piece called healthy marriage, what strengthening, what a building supporting, strong family,
supporting healthy marriage.
Those are for the ones who are already married. Then there's a third that's a community focus. I can't remember the name of it.
Community Healthy Marriage Initiative
something like that. But the idea there is to try to, you know, change the community attitudes through, you know, it's this, unlike the other two, there's no kind of demonstration with an experimental design and random assignment to test whether this works, but there will be sort of to saturate a community with different ideas. I don't know about in the Native American, but I know in the African American community now, 70% of children are born to unmarried parents. So this isn't, you know, in for whites it's 20%. So this is the modal way for children to be born in that community. And what's interesting is that then makes people they want to get married, and I talk about this in my presentation today. These couples want to get married, but they do not want to get divorced. They see marriage as a choice, whereas children are not a choice. Children come from God, and they are yours, and you to take care of them. They see marriage as a choice, and they see divorce is evidence of a bad mistake, and they don't want to make a bad mistake. Now, if you think about it, if you're in a community where where 70% of children are born outside of marriage, the divorce rates are very high. They're higher at all education levels among African Americans. So what are your chances, especially if you're a low income, of being able to have a successful marriage? Not very high, at least in the couple's imagination. So what they do is that they then come up with this list of things that they have to achieve in order to get married. So if you talk to them about why they're not married, they have all, you have to have two steady jobs, you have to have a house, you know, a real house that you own, you have to have a car. They have all these things. In the 50s, people used to get married in order to get these things. You know, they get married and then go after them together. That isn't the way these people see this at all. They think that in order to get married, they have to have all this stuff. And I think it is a safety. It's an insurance policy. It's because if I did have all that stuff, I might have a better chance at not failing, which is what a divorce. And so you can see this really creates, you know, a feedback effect, and it means fewer and fewer people do marry, and then the people who are married and making it are increasingly high-income people. And so then they look at, then they become further and further away from what is the average married couple in their community. So I think the whole idea of trying to understand both the effects of this on the community as well as how the community norms and sort of understanding of what marriage is, I think both of those are very important lines of research.
Comments, questions?
Yes.
I have a...
Please, your name and your...
Marie Cornwell, Sociology. One of the things I think the family, what we did as family scholars is first we conceptualized the nuclear family, and in doing that began to neglect the lateral relationships. So I know there's research and we know about grandmothers raising children, for example. But it seems to me like we don't know a whole lot about aunts and uncles and the lateral relationships. And your question about the tribe sort of raises, I think is related to that, to the extent that what happens sometimes in the tribe is that the mother's sister raises the child, or, you know, they have a much different notion about family because of the tribal connection. But I wonder about our social policy that really interrupts families, and I'm not talking about don't go to parents and teenage daughters who might be abused. You know, we want to get the teenage daughter out. What I'm asking is why we don't, as a policy, see if we can initiate some things that encourages and gives support to that lateral aunt-uncle configuration who could really provide support. I'm thinking of one single mom I know whose brother has basically become the dad. and, you know, takes the kid skiing and all of that. We just don't see that relationship, it seems like, in the literature. Or maybe I'm not reading the right place.
Well, I mean, for Indians, it's I think that's a great comment, and I think that anybody that has a strong focus on the family, it's sad that I think it's kind of been normalized out of, you know, we kind of say, yeah, it's important to have grandma and grandpa and aunt and uncle around, and all of a sudden, but we still need to preserve this nuclear family, and I think all of our focus has kind of been so much on that, preserving the nuclear family, that those other important components have been, I don't know, neglected, but at least not as, it doesn't hold as high of a priority. But one of the interesting things, for example, with the Indian Child Welfare Act, you know, it is set forth there, that there is a priority system for if there is a child that is abused or neglected, you go right to grandma, grandpa, aunt, and uncle, and that's where you've got to start with in saying, where are we going to place this child? But I think that that needs to be broadened as well, because I think that a lot of those informal networks are just so vital, not only for when the mom or dad leaves, but in this preventative approach and helping them get through some of their fragile status. But I just wanted to mention one thing as well with what Sarah said with regard to fathers leaving. One of the issues as well that Native people face on reservations is when fathers leave, they literally leave. The reservation, they usually leave the reservation and go off. And so that disjoint becomes even more because there's just employment opportunities are not there. And so it becomes even more problematic because you've got dad living down in Phoenix or somewhere else and his association with the children are that much difficult just by economic standards.
That's what I sort of heard him saying was that this idea, well, the extended family will somehow fill in, but if the men are all gone, that it'll have to be an extended family of women. that after so many generations, there won't even be an uncle to fill in, the father.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is we ought to pay attention to how to create communities where there are men, as well as just thinking, I mean, if we just assume that if we can just get people to get married, that'll create communities where there are men, that's not necessarily so, because the men may be driving an hour and a half a day to find work, you know, so are they really there? So I think we need to think broader than just that nuclear family.
I agree. I have a question.
Tim
Keaton, I'm a demographer, sometimes sociologist. So if the moms who are disadvantaged have several types of disadvantage, I would guess their siblings do too. So if you expect too much of extended families, it's going to further increase the inequality that you described in your paper. It's nice to have that as an option, but certainly not as the main policy solution.
Yeah, Tim, I don't think I said the main policy solution.
Well, I don't.
What I'm suggesting is that if there could be some policies that also recognize that where that was available to enhance it, that's not so bad.
Well, actually, there are some policies, like what you mentioned. There are the child welfare system does. There's a lot of foster, relative foster care. That is sort of the first line of, that's what happens with kids when they're, now that's pretty extreme. They're removed from their parents. That isn't sort of helping them help the parents. But there's also some policies that say when a single mother's very young, that she should live with the grandmother. The grandmother would provide more support. It turns out that it's not all as quite as rosy as it might seem in both those cases, because what's happened is that young mother who's had the child out of wedlock, one reason she may have gotten into this situation is she doesn't have a great relationship with her mother. So you're having the grandmother raise now the child of the mother, and there's a lot of evidence that there's a lot of conflict between the mother and the grandmother. In the case of the foster grandparents, it also gets very tricky because the foster, you're putting the relative in the position, say the mother, in order for the child to be taken away, the mother would either have to have a serious drug problem or be living with a man who had a serious problem or something. So now the relative is in the position of serving as supposed to be protecting the child, but protecting him from their own relative. And so that gets very complicated too.
Right. And what I tried to say, don't go to that story.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm not saying that we need to rely upon the extended family more. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is that if we go up to that level of people who are sort of just barely making it, I'm not talking, you know, I agree mm-hmm. that we've got to do something for these folks down here. But the ones that are just barely making it, that may have extended family, that are middle class, that could be benefited by some tax policies or whatever that allow them to still be heavily engaged in taking care of and providing economic support, that there's a group of people that we could help by recognizing
well, these people the child care funds can be used to pay, for instance, relatives to do child care.
If you have an aunt, mm-hmm. for example, who is can help send people to college, for example, she doesn't get the tax break. The only person that gets the tax break are the parents. So you've got a family where the parents can't quite do it, and we give them tax breaks. But if you've got family members around, there's no way to encourage them to participate in the investment of those children.
I think this is a good time for us to get our lunches, which have arrived. And I would invite you to just... to Steve. And let him proceed with his response.
Thank you. It's a pleasure for me to be here. I will say, since Elaine asked me to participate in this, I received a recent December 2005 National Vital Statistics Report from the Center for Disease Control. And in that, it said that in 2004, there were 1.5 million children who were born to women who weren't married, which was a record high. And they said that was 4% higher than 2003. And the actual percentage of births that are born to unmarried women increased to 35.7%. So I knew it was about one third, but I did, you know, 35.7% was the most recent figure. So yeah, that, I guess, highlights what we've been talking about. Professor McClanahan mentioned in her article. In thinking about, of course, the question of resources and the difference between the two, I thought of another area where it affects the resources, and you mentioned in your article, but and that's the area of crime, drug use, and incarceration. But, you know, typically the criminologists and criminal justice people kind of study that, and the sociologists and social work and others study the family stuff, and the two don't cross paths very much. But, of course, the people with fewer resources are the ones who are much more likely to be incarcerated. And maybe this isn't news to some of you, but, for example, the incarceration rate for African-American males is 8 times higher than for white males. And so when you talk about disadvantaged people generally, it's certainly much higher. When you talk about a community, like you mentioned, the American Indian community, if you take the number of males that are taken out of poor communities because of crime, drug use, and incarceration, it gets pretty high. And of course, when you look at those in terms of families, it's easy to say, well, those families were disrupted long before they went to prison. They're on drugs and they're committing crime and they're not around much. And that's probably true for a lot of them. On the other hand, however, if you think about resources for children and families, taking some of them out certainly is a deficit, and over half of men who are in prison are fathers, and 3/4 of women who are in prison are mothers. And so there's a lot of kids that are affected by that phenomenon. And then, of course, when they 95% of the people in prison get released sometime, and they enter our communities, and of course they try to reconnect with children and develop relationships, and so you can see the problem that can create. And of course, they, even if they have job skills, they haven't been using those for the time they're in prison, so they're disadvantaged in being able to form families and support those children and those kind of things. And so, you know, one area where I think we could look at, which needs a lot more research, is the area of incarceration in prison and how that affects the family relationships. And as I thought about that and that whole field, that I had another idea about policy that you talked about. Earlier we talked about the problem of the marriage penalty because they didn't have the money or didn't want to increase the amount. And maybe these are different policy realms and we don't talk about them, but all of you are probably aware that in the last 20 years the prison population has increased like 400%, from like 500,000 in 1980 to over 2 million in today, and the correctional expenditures during that time have increased eightfold. And so we've had a tremendous increase there, and of course there is debate about that and the good that it does, but that is largely a policy decision, meaning like since about 1993 or 94, crime rates have not gone up, they've actually been going down. And the increasing prison population is due to things such as the war on drugs and three strikes and you're outlaws, which put people in prison for longer times. And so that's increased the prison population, and of course if you look at the total pot of dollars that we have, if we're spending a lot more on the correctional system, that's less for us to spend on the earned income tax credit and other policies like that, which you mentioned. And so, you know, one of the things I thought of, we certainly need more basic and policy-oriented research on alternatives to prisons, maybe how we can fund, channel some of that money in other ways to do some of the things that you talked about and the policy things that you suggested. And of course, one area that goes beyond the prison, of course, is substance abuse. In the last couple of years, we've interviewed a lot of people in prison and that are out on parole, and large majorities of them have a substance abuse problem of some kind. And if you look at the dollars that we spend on that problem, we spend a lot more money on law enforcement interdiction than we do on prevention and treatment, which is another area where we could, I think, have dollars to help fund some of the policy problems that we mentioned. I guess finally, and I'm not an expert on this area, but hearing people talk about the resources, it seems like there's a lot of discussion of, you know, minimum wage and living wage and jobs for people, which is important, but it seems like the other side of that to help solve that is more help for job training and education. Do we put as much discussion and dollars and emphasis in that, which would help solve the resource for some of the families and make fathers more attractive as husbands and so on. So those are a few of the comments that I had on the issues we've talked about, some of the research and areas that I thought were relevant.
Sure. I think the incarceration point is huge, and I think that we're just beginning to realize that the same group of people, I mean, in a way, as you were talking, I was thinking about, well, you can take them, the fathers can leave the reservation, but another way of leaving is being locked up, right? And that is what's happening. One of the biggest surprises of the Fragile Family Study was what a high percentage of these unmarried fathers had spent time in jail. It's like about 40% have spent some time, and about 20% of those are for some kind of a violent crime, but 80% are for a nonviolent crime, and a lot of it is drug selling and that kind of thing. So I think the incarceration policies we've had, as you exactly said, the changing of the rules that keep people in longer and that are much harsher for just drug offenses has had a big effect on removing the men from the communities and also making them less marriageable in some sense, because obviously they may have low human capital to begin with, and they do, but being in prison is not likely to increase your human capital. And there's also evidence that employers discriminate against someone with a prison record.
Right.
And but then the other part of it that connects with these marriage programs or these relationship skills, if you can imagine a set of skills needed to survive that would not be conducive for a good male-female relationship, you know, it would be prison, right? The kind of way that these men, the kind of skills they have to develop to survive in prison are not the kinds of skills that are going to make them good husbands and fathers when they come out. So I have a colleague at Princeton who's writing a book about incarceration, but one of the chapters is going to be about the family effects. And I think this is a very interesting area for research, and because I don't think people have, family people have put the prison piece together. It's very hard to figure out, are these guys, you know, bad before they went? Did this prison actually make them worse? One of the big points that I'm going to make this afternoon, although I don't have a lot of time to make it, is that I think that the birth of the child is a very special moment in these people's lives, and that it's an opportunity for men to change, to turn around, and I suppose the mothers too, but especially the men. I've been involved in poverty programs for a long time, studying them, and the programs that are trying to create more human capital in these high school dropout men, the evaluations suggest they're not successful. We've been trying them for 30 years. They have very, very low success rates, with the exception of Job Corps, which is one group, which literally the guys are in residence in. But the others are very unsuccessful, and the reason they're unsuccessful is the men don't stick with them. It's not that they don't have a good idea that would work, it's that the guys drop out after a couple of weeks. And I've heard the same kinds of things for some of the drug treatment and substance abuse programs. So the problem that I hear from the program administrators is they need motivation. They need to motivate these very disadvantaged men. Well, it's possible that the birth of the child could be a motivator. There's some evidence about men literally turning themselves in when the police are looking for them. The policemen at the hospitals that we go to collect the data have said to us, they literally go to the hospital because they know the guy will show up to see the baby. So there's a lot of folklore among the nurses and the hospital people and the police people that the father wants to see the baby. And as you'll see when I do my talk, there's enormous amount of, the fathers have very high hopes at the time of the marriage initiative. I think that offering these couples services and education programs around the time of the birth of the child might be more effective than offering them those services at just another time in their development. I think that the birth of the, maybe it's the first child that's really key, I don't know about that. But I do think that there's a motivating factor there. We do have a set of programs out here designed to help. And if you can somehow put those together, you might get a bigger bang for the buck.
Questions, comments?
I have a question. I'm Gib Dyer.
Your name?
I'm Gib Dyer from the Marriott School. And I'm interested in Steve's research also because my son's at Illinois studying incarcerated. Bob, maybe something Freudian about that, but, but anyway, my question is more related to these single mothers. And have we done some good luck, coming out of the business school, and I do studies on family businesses, and we're doing some studies, we're starting to do what with single mothers who, in our center, we're looking at poverty and things of that nature. But have they tracked single mothers, what happens to them when they marry, whether they end up marrying the father of these children or it's someone else, and then track longitudinally the impact on those children, and do we see a significant effect in terms of their sense of well-being or self-esteem or performance in school? Or, say, in your fragile families study, do we not track, once they get married, do they drop out and we not track them over time? I'd just be interested in what empirical evidence we have about the impact of marriage of women who are in that category.
So far we've followed them for 5 years. We're in the middle of the 5-year interview now. We have funding to re-interview everyone at 9 years. What happens is a very small percentage marry during that 5 years. Even of the, a large percent are cohabiting at birth, but hardly a very small number of them, even 20% of them end up marrying each other. What happens is they they form serial relationships, and then they have a new child with the new partner. And this is a whole other area of research that I think is just about to take off. It's called, people have called, are calling it different things, multiple partner fertility, multi-partnered fertility. They've got these names, and nothing's sort of gelled yet. But the fact is, it's what you're getting is you're getting a mother with three children who have a different father someplace else. And then you've got a man who has is maybe living with one mother and a child, but he's got two or three children in different households. So this is creating a very, so there, this is part of two things. One is instability. There's a lot of instability in the relationships. And then there's this complexity that's creatively complicated. And there's a lot of just noise that's associated with that. You know, you gotta it's running a business, you know, it's just, there's more to figure out. There's more to negotiate. This guy doesn't want to come on this day. This parent does want to do that. Everything, all the schedule, just imagine the scheduling. Well, imagine if you've got, you know, six different households involved in the family lives of these two adults of maybe this one common child. So that's, in fact, my colleague Ron Mincy, who in a way got this whole study started. He was at the Ford Foundation for years and funded a lot of these fatherhood initiatives throughout the country. And it was really his inspiration that started the Fragile Family Study. But he's written a paper drawing on this multi-partner fertility idea called Who Should Marry Whom? Because the point is, if you wait downstream, you know, you can't get the married.
Well, I think one of the fair criticisms that has come from the left is that they don't anticipate that marriage will have the same level of benefits for low-income couples as it will for others, because it's a very different kind of family structure and situation, much more complex. They're with their human resources, human capital, going to other families, to other children. And I think it's an empirical question that we need to address, but it's a fair critique that marriage may not have the salutary impact that we see it having in more, or less complex, stable, middle-class families.
And Alan, we don't have empirical evidence on those. Yeah.
Well,
we know the instability is bad.
Yeah.
That's true of remarriage, step-parent, you know. We know that every change in the personnel has, there's a cost to that.
But whether there could be a stabilizing factor when you do get these low-income couples married, I'm not sure that
don't want to just get them married if they don't stay married.
Right.
That's for sure. Yeah. This is, you know, marching everyone down and getting them married is not the point of the whole thing is to stabilize the environments. And if that doesn't work, just having them marry each one of these new partners, I don't think would do anything. So the point is that you want to early on create
early,
a stable relationship so the kid doesn't have multiple.
Now, I believe you said in your paper that if you talk about the differences between these differences and whether they're due to marital status per se or other things, and you said there isn't good empirical data on that in your paper. You said there are good theoretical reasons why to think fathers would help, which I think relates to your question. But that suggests that it's important that we do some additional longitudinal research
on it. Enormous, yeah. Enormous. Because there's so many things about the people who marry that are different from the people who don't marry that, you know, what is it? Their kids certainly do better, but why? I do think that one of the mechanisms is the instability. I think that marriage creates stability, but if it doesn't, then I don't, you know, so I see that most of the gains to marriage, whether they're the father works hard, he works longer hours, all of that, all of those gains, the mental health or health gains in marriage because your spouse is always telling you, did you go to see the doctor? Did you, you know, there's that stuff. But that comes about because the relationship is long term and you're kind of investing in your spouse because you think he or she's going to be around a while, so you're trying to keep them healthy and all of that kind of thing. I don't think you would get that benefit just by getting people to have a marriage license.
I know that the prisoners that we interviewed fit the profile that you just described in the past. I mean, there are many of the men that we interviewed who had multiple children. From
comment while we were eating that they have multiple partners, but they tend to upgrade.
Yes.
Could you comment on that?
Well, this is something we just discovered, and I'll show you a slide about this. We're writing a paper called Mother or Does Mother Know Best? No. So the big surprise is that we looked at the same mother when she broke up with the original father that got her into our study. But by age 5, we looked at which mothers had new partners. And then we compared the characteristics of the new partners with the original partner of that mother. This is in certain domains, they've very different in domestic violence, like 10 times different. Very different in drug abuse, much lower incarceration history, much less likely to have no high school degree. Not a little bit more likely to have some college, but that's not the big. So what they've really done is pulled up the bottom. So the question that, and we're just beginning this analysis, but one of the questions is, you know, is this just an effect of learning in the sense older and wiser? To go back just a minute, the conventional wisdom is that these women aren't very attractive on the marriage market, the single mother with a kid. So there is research that shows that a mother with a kid is less likely to marry and is less likely to get a good partner than a woman without a kid. So, you know, you might, the women are not settling for less. You have half of them are not repartnering. So there, and the ones who are partnering are means that, you know, in the calculus of would this kid who was mother, you have to add into that, what was the father, what did he bring to the, what does this new guy bring, and then what's the cost of the change, which we know is a negative, and what's the cost of being in this more complicated family, which is a negative. It's possible that the mother has, you know, upgraded enough so that the overall benefit is even greater if she doesn't stay with the first guy.
Are you, I'm assuming you're comparing the...
Could you give us your name?
Richard McClendon from the Center for Economic Studies. The upgraded father, is that from, or are you going back to the original?
Yeah, we're using, yeah, we've done it a couple of ways. We age him up. Give him his right age. But we don't change the other characteristics, because we're trying to think about who she was choosing. You know, at the time she married, she chose this guy, and now she's chosen this guy. And it turns out that in the interim period, if we did upgrade update our information, he looked a lot worse than he did originally. But that could be because they broke up, yeah. Right? or it could be that he went bad, and that's partly why she broke up. It's hard to know that.
It just seemed like there'd be an age control that you'd want to work with.
Yeah, I agree.
In those years over time.
And the other, so one idea is they just get smarter as they get older. But another idea is that having a child changes them. That once they become a mother, the idea of what's an attractive man is different. You know, they're now looking for someone to help the kid. We haven't had time, but we can check that, because we can look at the mothers who are having their first child and then upgrade as compared to women who are had multiple births. Because you'd expect, if it's really about becoming a mother makes you think differently about a partner, then you should see it with those first-time mothers. When they upgrade, there should be a bigger difference.
Your name?
Kelly McCoy. This is actually referring back. Gordon brought up an interesting point. He talked about, just in passing, the notion of casino tribes as compared to non-casino tribes, and the idea of when money's present versus absent. And that brought me back to Sarah's article that we were given to read. And you talk about the divergence that's occurring as a result of education. To what extent is that divergence merely a reflection of more money versus less money as compared to other buffers that may come from education itself? Are you familiar with any research that sort of pulls apart the income versus education issue?
Someone has done a paper, and I don't have it on the top of my head, using the casino as an instrument for what happens when you get this exogenous income shock. I don't I think it shows the kids do better, but I'm not positive.
And what I know about that is it also goes extremes too. So if you have drug problems, for example, in Phoenix, we did a study with drug and alcohol abuse on a reservation, and somebody had done one 10 years ago. We saw that when they tried, before the casino money started to play into it, they were doing little marijuana here and there, stealing cigarettes. Now they're into cocaine and a lot more high-end worse drugs because now they have access, which is not just an Indian problem, but that's a socioeconomic status.
We see that in high schools too, where middle-income high schools, the kids are doing marijuana, whereas in the higher-income high schools, kids are more likely to be doing the more expensive drugs because they can afford it.
So, but that's about the extent that I've looked at. As far as resources-wise, like we just visited the Choctaw Reservation, and they, 30 years ago, they were the second, which is in Mississippi, the second poorest county.
We're all familiar now, thanks to Jack Abramoff.
No. The second poorest county in the United States, right behind Pine Ridge, which is another Indian reservation. But they got into casino money. They are now the biggest player in the state of Mississippi. Because they're in the middle of nowhere too. It's Philadelphia, Mississippi, which is 2 hours from anywhere. But they are, and they've built new hospitals. If you want to go to college, any child will pay full up to as much college as you want to get. And just the social resources are just amazing for them.
So is someone studying how that's affecting marriage?
And so. That I haven't heard anybody doing that, but that's,
Well, the idea is, we talk about, is it just a matter of throwing more money? Really considering, that is more complex than just the money issue.
Great. Well, that goes back to the fact that really marriage is a status, and that you expect higher status people to be more focused on achieving that status, because if you're not married, it signals that you're less than. So,
that's very good.
Right. Yeah.
In this discussion about the buffers and the benefits of education, and when we see these trends to delay marriage and to delay parenthood and the possible benefits of helping achieve that, I'd be interested in discussion from the panel and from others. Is there any drag on that effect that as that delay goes further and further in life, there's exposure to other premarital risk factors that we've seen identified? Cohabitation, premarital sexual behavior, those types of things, so that as that delay goes on, the interplay there of both the benefits that can be gathered, but also the possible risk factors and prolonged exposure to those, and what impact that might have when people do make that transition to marriage.
I'm wondering, particularly in these low-income populations, my guess is that cohabitation is nearly universal.
And among middle-class kids, it's very, very high.
It's high, but at least you've got a population there. So I wonder, Jason, in this population, if those risks are a constant, because there's little variation in that. And so maybe a constant doesn't affect the equation.
So possibly the variation then is in our high education sample, that if two of those educational goals is also coupled with a strategy of cohabitation or extended premarital sexual partnerships en route to that, that might capture some of the variation within that population as those things have been identified as risk factors for marital stability.
Yeah, and I just wonder how much of that variation you will get in these more disadvantaged populations, and so it may not contribute further risk. I'm just speculating.
I think this would be a good time to ask Dean McElvey to kind of wrap up our discussion and give us all some wisdom. Take home message.
Well, I don't know that I've got a take home message other than thank you, especially to Susan just left and Robin Shumway, who arranged for the lunch. really want to thank Sarah McClanahan. This has been a wonderful session and just the kind of thing we'd hoped for. Our purpose in these sessions, especially given the diversity of disciplines around this room, are to get ideas flowing, to think about research agendas, to think about how this might influence something you're working on or you might think about working on, and if not now, then a year from now. It's also just great fun to have someone as engaging and bright and creative as Sarah McClanahan with us. We need those kinds of opportunities from time to time to energize us, and we thank you very much for honoring us by coming this year. Kudos as well to our three faculty members who brought very different perspectives to their reading of the article and did a superb job. Followed the time constraints, but gave us all a different application or a different approach that I think engaged Professor McClanahan and all of us. And so to Alan and to Gordon and to Steve, thank you. It seemed to me that there are a bunch of questions, and I'm not in but if not, here's a little menu to get us started, individually and collectively. What explains the findings that about the positives for the top quartile? And this is really Kelly's point just now about education. We've heard about education being clearly a part of it. What are the other independent variables that seem to predict it? And how important are values? You're here at a place where values are important to us, but are we being idiosyncratic? Kevin and I were talking earlier about this being helpful because it pushes us out of our normal way of thinking in our particular culture. And it's interesting to me because it runs counter to the popular culture. Our session last year, Jim Wilson talked about how our culture devalues marriage and family. So for me at least, there's a disconnect between the impression in the popular media and the perception in the minds of lots of students, including students at a predominantly LDS school who are very afraid of marriage. They're afraid of failure, the kinds of things you're seeing. We're seeing delays in getting into marriage, some hesitancy about it. So we've got this cultural phenomenon going where kids are anxious here and even more elsewhere, but it's happening and it's successful. Do they intuitively know that? And so they enter into it even when the cultural signals seem to be counter. Just one set of questions around the top quartile. Then, equally important, is what explains the findings about the bottom quartile. Is it the economic tips to marriage? Is it education and aspirations, role models? Is it something about community, back to the prisons and the tribal community? All of which seem interesting to me, and any one of which would be, I think, a useful contribution if it hasn't been fully explored. I like the idea about marriage enhancing social capital. I'm not sure I know how that works. I think intuitively it rings true for me. Maybe there's good work going on in that. If so, that's, I think, a fruitful area for a long-term list here. A fourth one, and there's several in the room who do fathering research. Why does time away from father serve to be an important variable? What is it about the interaction? I realize we can measure it and we can find a statistical relationship, but I want to probe deeper. What is it about that? And what is it about the age 15 that you mentioned, which I found interesting? I don't know if that's just a breakpoint in the data, but the whole fathering area seems to be very central to a lot of what we're talking about today. And I think important. I think Gordon's point about absent fathers and the extent to which substitutes work, grandfathers, church leaders, community figures, and then the biggie, which is really grows out of Steve's, is what policy differences work. If we were to spend more money to try and help with this problem, would we be wise to spend it on education? Would we be wise to spend it on the marriage initiative? Would we be wise to try and lift the economic opportunity? Maybe that's through education, maybe it's through livable wage. I was reading Sarah's article the same weekend that the New York Times had the Sunday Magazine section on livable wages. And the two coming together struck me as an interesting coincidence, because I do think that floor is very important to the hope or the expectation, and it gets into things like healthcare and so forth. So if we really had to choose, and we're always going to have to choose in a budget or policy setting, what would you tell us to spend in, those of us who are not experts in this, and why? Education, marriage initiatives, livable wage, and it can't be all of the above.
Oh.
So there's some examples to me of what I walk away with today saying, wow, there's a rich agenda for us who are interested in social science and family-related matters. Let me again just take a moment to thank you. Many of you have 1 o'clock classes to go to, and Sarah didn't get a chance to finish her lunch. So with this, we'll invite you all to rejoin us tonight at 7 o'clock, the Joseph Smith Building Auditorium. I think you can tell we're in for a great treat. We look forward to seeing you there tonight at 7 o'clock. Thanks again for coming.